It is a wonderful morning. We had a terrible injury at soccer yesterday. We do need everybody to pray for little Kathy Stewart. She blew her knee in a terrible way. But I think that based on where the choir put their chairs, they wanted to try to top it today with me. I don't think I'll get through this sunrise service without a fall. But it is good to see everybody. It's a beautiful morning. And we thank you for coming out. We'd like you to stand and sing He Lives With Us.
Some have died. He also appeared to James and then to all of the
apostles. Finally, he appeared to me, even though I am like someone who was born at the wrong time. I am the least important of all the apostles. In fact, I caused so much trouble for God's church that I don't even deserve to be called an apostle. But God was kind. He made me what I am, and his wonderful kindness wasn't wasted. I worked much harder than any of the other apostles, although it was really God's kindness that worked and not me. But it doesn't matter if I preached or they preached. All of you believed the message just the same. If we preach that Christ was raised from death, how can some of you say that the dead will not be raised to life? If they won't be raised to life, Christ himself wasn't raised to life. And if Christ wasn't raised to life, our message is worthless, and so is your faith. And if the dead won't be raised to life, we've told lies about God by saying that he raised Christ to life when he really did not. So if the dead won't be raised to life, Christ wasn't raised to life. Unless Christ was raised to life, your faith is useless, and you're still living in your sins. And those people who died after putting their faith in him are completely lost if their hope in Christ is good only for this life, and we are worse off than anyone else. But Christ has been raised to life, and he makes us certain that others will also be raised to life. Just as we all die because of Adam, we will all be raised to life because of Christ. Adam brought death to all of us, and Christ will bring life to all of us. But we must each wait our turn. Christ was the first to be raised to life, and the people will be raised to life when he returns. Then after Christ has destroyed all powers and forces, the end will come, and he will give the kingdom to God the Father. Christ will rule until he puts all his enemies under his power, and the last enemy he destroys will be death. When the scriptures say that he will put everything under his power, they don't include God. It was God who put everything under the power of Christ, and everything is under the power of God's Son, and he will put himself under the power of God, who put everything under his Son's power. Then God will mean everything to everyone. If the dead are never going to be raised to life, what will people do who are being baptized for them? Why are they being baptized for those dead people? And why do we always risk our lives and face death every day? The pride that I have in you is because of Christ Jesus our Lord is what makes me say this. What do you think I gained by fighting wild animals in Ephesus if the dead are not raised to life? Let's eat and drink. Tomorrow we die. Don't fool yourselves. Bad friends will destroy you. Be sensible and stop sinning. You should be embarrassed that some people still don't know about God. This is the resurrection as the early church knew it. And Paul was very certain to tell what everybody always wants to know. Everybody wants to know proof. The proof of people living around. Paul basically said that I can give you the names and addresses of about 500 people who saw Jesus resurrected. You're having trouble believing this story? Well, I can have you meet people who were there, people who've seen it. And the thing that does for our faith is it builds us up to let us know that there were people there, there were people who've seen it, there were people who would actually talk about it and discuss it, and people went to them and gained their faith through that. So they had witnesses, and knowing that, it brought the scriptures and it brought the story of Jesus to great truths. It brought the story to where we believe that we will be risen from the dead. And the church struggles in the belief that we will be raised from the dead. All you have to do is go to funeral services. I've been to funeral services of families that have been Christians for years and years and years. And I see how the family acts. And I see the importance of clinging to earthly things and not scriptural things. I get in trouble all the time because people say things like, well, you know, I have to tell you, the Browns had almost made the playoffs the year before Dad died. And then Dad died, and the Browns were terrible. And the New York Giants had won the Super Bowl before, and they were undefeated, and the Browns were scheduled to play on Monday Night Football. And during this time period, one of my dad's best friends died. He was also a huge Browns fan. And on Monday Night Football, the terrible Browns who had not won a game destroyed the Super Bowl champion, New York Giants. Okay? And I'm at the funeral of the other man who passed away. And everybody at the funeral was saying, well, Floyd and Harvey sure reached down from heaven and took care of that. And that's sweet. God gave my father power over the NFL. Amen. I don't think that's anywhere scriptural. It's part of our believing system. We don't have a concept. Because we struggle with the fact that we are raised, and our spirits are raised, the Apostle Paul says later that to be absent from the body is to be with Jesus. And we struggle with that. We have a tough time. We can't go through that concept. We can't believe that if we die, we're with Jesus, which is what he promised, which is what he said in the scriptures. We can't believe that later our bodies will be raised. We have to come up with other stories. We have to come up with other concepts even within our own faith. Because we just struggle too hard believing that death is coming. One of the greatest sermons that I've heard is Michael Carr. Michael Carr talked about a minister that he had, a seminary professor that meant the world to him. And he said, I made him my rabbi and I studied with him for 12 years. And he said, I learned everything that I could about how to be a Christian, how to walk with Christ from this man. And he said, I received a letter about 2 years ago from him that said, would you like to see how a Christian dies? So he said, I went and took care of him the last year and a half of his life to watch how a Christian dies. Because a Christian dies differently than normal people. A Christian dies without fear. A Christian dies with hope. Christian dies with belief. Christian dies with the knowledge of where they're going, that there is no fear in death. Christian dies knowing that they're going to be face to face with the one who gave us all, each and every one of them. The one that they've celebrated every year, Easter services. The ones that they've celebrated every Sunday. The one that they've celebrated every day in prayer and scripture reading. And they know that and they live that in their heart. And when that changes our knowledge, it changes who we are. That is what we become when we become a Christian. It's not when we become that way when we have a death sentence. We become that way the day we become followers of Christ. And as we mature in that, we grow and grow and grow, which is another problem where we've come within the church, because the Apostle Paul says this to the church. Now I want you to understand, the Apostle Paul is saying this to a 30-year-old church. And so today we're looking at a 2,000-year-old church. And instead of it being stopped when the Apostle Paul writes a letter to the Corinth church, it is a problem that has grown even larger. And it says, you should be embarrassed that some people still don't know about God. You ever think about that as an indictment on the church? If you walk through the towns and the streets and the cities, and you walk through the malls, or you go to a pizza restaurant, or you go to any place, and you see that there are a large amount of people who don't know about God, who do you blame for that? Do you blame television? Or it's very easy today, let's blame Obama. Right? He's the man. It's his fault they don't believe in God. Right? Or can we just put the blame on the lame bodies? It's the church's fault. It's the church's fault. And the Apostle Paul has summed it up here. Why other people don't believe in God? Because the church doesn't believe. If the church doesn't firmly have a rock solid foundation on that Jesus Christ died and 3 days later rose for our sins, walked for 40 days, then ascended with the promise to come back. If we don't have a firm foundation in that, which it is mind-boggling. I want you to think today, if it was on the news, if somebody died in a hospital, they took their body to the morgue, and 3 days later, there's a knock on the morgue. The door asking, let me out. Everybody's pretty shocked. People are going to talk about that for a long time. Long time. As a matter of fact, they just did a TV show about it. It's called Resurrection. I don't even know if it got canceled or what. If it made it, I watched a couple episodes and then started driving me nuts and watching. All these people that died start showing up in town. They're about to see it. And it was pretty soon turned out to be aliens and planted those seeds from some kind of alien pods or something. But anyway, People were wondering what was going on, but they saw the dead back to life. It's changing because you know what? We don't see the dead come back to life. We brag about stuff. We had a miracle in this town. A man had a heart attack and died, and in 20 minutes they brought him back. 20 minutes, which, you know, Butch, it's mind-boggling. And, you know, there's a member of the vineyards, and we praised God and celebrated with them. And you know, the thing with the vineyards was they said, you know, he was raised from the dead. And how blessed they were with that. And the miracles happened. And I'm not taking away from that. Jesus was dead 3 days. 3 days. I love Chuck Swindoll teaches. And I don't get into it a lot because it confuses people. But Chuck Swindoll will go in and he will say that there was an early Passover that was held every year during that Passover week. And Chuck believes that Jesus was crucified on Wednesday. And that way, he was arrested on Wednesday. He was in the ground. Thursday, kind of, 3 days, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, Grand Prix, which actually meant 3 24-hour days. And he does it, the point is that he was dead 3 days in the ground. And then the Apostle Paul goes on to say, 500 people. You know this, you can believe this. Well, if you know this, you can believe this is the truth. Number one, Jesus says, if you believe in me and follow me, you will not die. So are you going to live your life to not die? Number one motivating factor in people is the fear of death. It's worse than the fear of money, the fear of losing loved ones, and people are scared for their own lives. It makes me think of the movie Titanic, and you see what some of the people did to try to survive, how some of the men tried to get on the boats, because it was women and children first, and the disgusting thing people tried to do in acts of survival. And historically, we are known to do this kind of things because we are afraid about dying. The death has been conquered. Jesus Christ has conquered death. We will never die if we believe. So we are the group that believes. We are the church. We are the people. And we need to understand that we should be embarrassed that there are people who don't know about God. And we should make that our driving force, not just our children, not just the people in our own home, but anyone that we can meet to show the love of God, show His grace and mercy. Because at the cross, we're the enemies of God, and Jesus died for His enemies. And then rose again so that they would never have to die if they would only decide to follow Him. What an incredible message of grace and mercy. And that's what Easter's about. That's why we're here celebrating. That's what the empty tomb means. God loved us so much, even though we were far from Him, that He died for each other in our lives. And that message should never embarrass us, and that we should take it to the entire world. So I hope this blesses you this morning. I hope this is your thought process. And I hope this is the message that you're ready to share. And I have a favorite Easter song that I can't make it without hearing. I'm now, you know, technology, I've got a whole bunch of friends that got up and put this on Facebook. So I've already heard it a few times this morning, but if you'll please stand and sing the Easter song. Thank you. tell you, if you ever want to hear a version, Keith Green's best. I think when a songwriter sings, there's a group called the Second Chapter of Acts and had these two sisters that could, I'll tell you, that one. And their brother was right there with them. Anyway, let's go to the Lord in prayer. I don't know if they're ready. Hey, breakfast people!
Hey, I think we're ready.
There is, they're ready. All right. God, we thank you so much for the many blessings that you pour out of me. And the fact that you let your son die for us, the Lord Jesus, that you died and rose again. And we have confidence in that. We ask that you would bless us today, that as we sing these songs and pray that we are embarrassed that there are people out there that do not know you, and help us to work to bring them all to you, to glorify you, to see everyone come to your kingdom. We ask that you bless this food, nourish our bodies, and help us have wonderful fellowship in you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Just to give you some instructions.